I think there are two very distinctive types of ethics. Personal ethics, which is exactly whether I believe investing in the arms trade is okay and therefore I'm happy to bank with a set of banks who may use my money for that, or whether actually I choose to bank with an ethical bank that gives me absolute assurance that those sorts of investments that I'm going to make are in things that I personally agree are the appropriate use of my money. I think in professional life, ethics are not debatable. They are what may be described as professional standards. So if you're an accountant, you must file accounts, you must undertake audits in a particular way that is set out by the professional bodies that govern those industries. In public relations, that is set out under the Royal Charter for the Chartered Institute of Public Relations and manifests itself in a way that our members sign up to a code of conduct. So every single one of our 11,000 plus members has signed up to a code of conduct, which is a set of ethics or a set of professional standards, and by those they must operate. So they're based on integrity, confidentiality, competence and transparency. So the code is laid out in detail, and I guess if people are interested to find out more about that, it's laid out very clearly on the CIPR website. If you are a member, then every year a copy of the code is sent to you when you renew your membership. That's a new thing that we're starting. I think how the elements of the CIPR code are put into practice in professional life is something that we do need to explain more thoroughly. And from April 2015, everybody who is active in continuous professional development will have to do a module on ethics. And that will give some ethical dilemmas around competency, around confidentiality, around integrity, around professionalism that say, in this situation, what is the correct thing to do? And you will not be able to file your continuous professional development for the year unless you've done that module. So at the moment we're developing it. There will be the opportunity, of course, to do that online, and that will be the mandatory model. We hope that people will take up more reading around ethics, whether that's reading books, papers, whether that's attending workshops that are put on within the regions and nations, or indeed some of our specific groups that deal with, for example, financial services. The City and Financial Group might put on something about ethics within their environment, and how the structures of something like the Chartered Institute of Public Relations Code of Conduct transposes over to the Financial Services Association's professional standards. I think public relations is an honourable profession. I think it is an ethical profession. I think if you are a member of the Chartered Institute of Public Relations, you are defined by your ability to uphold the code of conduct. We are doing a lot of work to promote that, both to members and to employers. We don't shy away from striking people out of membership if they don't adhere to the code. We did that for the very first time in the 1950s, and we did that for the most recently last year. I think, compare ourselves all the time as public relations professionals to other professions, including to journalism. I don't think anybody could say that journalism has the upper hand in terms of ethics or moral standing because of what's happened recently. I think we've seen the ground pulled from right underneath journalists to say you have the upper hand. And I think, you know, just we're talking now towards the end of the middle of March, you know, we've seen very recently very prominent members of the public standing up and talking about how their lives have been ruined by journalists with unethical practice. All I can say is, if you are a member of the Chartered Institute of Public Relations, or if you have concerns about someone who is, then you should, and you have a duty, to report them to the Chartered Institute, and we will investigate whether they are acting ethically or not. Ethics in professional life are not negotiable. You would no more entrust your accounts to somebody who's quite good with a calculator and likes figures as you would I would suggest entrust your reputation for someone who owns a laptop and quite likes words. There have got to be standards, there have got to be professional codes of conduct that people have to adhere to. And I believe, and I've worked in this profession for 15 years, that it is honourable and it is professional. For the 10 years before that, I worked in journalism, and I think there are honourable and professional people in journalism who work to similar standards. I think there's really basic advice in life which can be used in professional life, which is, if it doesn't feel right, if it seems too good to be true, the chances are it is. I think my advice to anybody starting out in public relations is find a mentor, find somebody outside of your organisation. Organisations like the Chartered Institute of Public Relations, like the Public Relations Consultancy Association, provide mentoring services. Find someone who you can talk to in confidence. You should have a proper contract for mentoring. It's not a chat, that's socialising. Mentoring is quite different. It should be a professional arrangement with someone that you can trust to have confidential conversations with. And certainly in my career, it's been those relationships where I have been able to go and say, I have concerns about this board recommendation. I need to speak against it. I need some help. I need some confidence to be able to do that. I think as you go through your career, there will be moments when you are faced with hard decisions, whether to stay with an organisation that perhaps is not operating in the way that you believe is correct, or to leave. And certainly when I have left those organisations, that has only been a good thing for me. I think being clear on where your passion lies. You can't be, I believe, a good public relations professional if you don't believe in what you're doing. You know, I've had a very interesting career across a whole different realm of different areas, from international development to public transport to healthcare. Now I work with a restaurant, I work with an NHS provider, I work with mentoring clients. Some of my team work with someone who's producing a brand new type of bra. Now, we believe in all of those things. We think they're all good, they all have benefits, but we work to a professional set of standards. And I would say that is the best advice. If I could give any advice, it would be that, to be clear on what your professional set of standards are, get some support around you. And certainly my experience, particularly of working in-house and now working with clients, is to be clear that that is the code of conduct that I operate under, and that in a sense is my insurance. That is me saying, if you ask me to do something that I do not believe is in the best interest of my profession, I won't do it. I think that when you're starting out in your career, you are in a very vulnerable position at times. You're the new person, you want to make a good impression, you want to be seen to be willing. I think if someone asks you to do something that you think is not correct, you should make a note of that. That would be my first piece of advice. Every job I've had a black book in which I make file notes, not because I'm planning to tell tales, but because for my own benefit, maybe in a year's time, maybe in a week's time, maybe in 10 years' time, if someone comes back to me and says, did you know about this? I am very clear both about what I knew and who I told. I think if you feel that you are being asked to keep a secret, you should ask yourself why you're being asked to be kept, for that secret to be kept. All good organisations don't keep secrets. If it's a good story, they want to tell it. If it's an issue, they want to overcome it and become better and become learn from that experience. So I think if you're ever asked to keep a secret, an alarm bell should go off. I think if anyone offers you money in an underhand way or in a way that feels underhand, an alarm bell should go off. And I think the basic principles of professional standards within an organisation, whether that's in relation to your gender, your sexuality, your religion, alarm bell should go off if any of that is ever called into question, or you feel you are benefiting from that or being penalised because of it. And there are huge amounts of people within the PR profession at senior levels who would offer support and advice. And I think one of the brilliant things about starting out now is we're all so much more accessible. You know, not a week goes by without someone contacting me via Twitter or LinkedIn to ask if I would spend 10 minutes to give them some advice on something. And if I can, I will. And I know I'm not alone in senior practitioners wanting to give support and advice to people coming into the profession. I think if you want to get a career in PR and you're just starting out, whether you're just coming to the end of your degree course or you've already completed it and you're looking for your first or your second job, I think you have to do a lot of preparation. So I wanted to be a journalist when I was at school. I started the school newspaper. I volunteered on the hospital radio. I got some work experience with my local BBC radio station. Now, I know work experience is not so easy to come by, but some of those other things, particularly now that you can set up your own blog, you can undertake a lot of interviews and post those. I think if I was interviewing somebody now who had done nothing apart from get their degree course, they probably wouldn't get a job with me. I want to know that they're serious about it. I want to know that they've done some preparation. I think the other thing is about being passionate. It's hard work. Any job is hard work. Working in public relations is hard work. You need to be passionate about it. You need to believe in it. You need to be interested and have an interesting mind. And, you know, reading newspapers that are not within your comfort zone, listening to radio programmes, watching television programmes, taking a TED talk in and writing about what you've learned from it. I think showing that you've got real passion for what you're applying for will set you apart from the crowd. And that's, I guess, my third tip is, what is your differentiating factor? If you were applying all your knowledge to yourself, you almost need to run your own public relations campaign, which is, you know, I, Mary Jones, are the best person to take on to do this fashion account because here's all the evidence that will back up what I'm telling you, which is I'm passionate about fashion, I'm really interested in it, I've done some work experience here, I've interviewed this person, I've bought that person coffee, I've got all this. You know, whether it's your scrapbook or your blog, I don't really care what the method is. What I would be looking for is that real commitment that I'm not just buying someone who's going to operate at a professional standard, which I would expect and would obviously look for, but there are lots of people who are going to come and present like that. What I would look for is those added extras, that passion, that preparation, and the commitment to wanting to do a really good job. I think that the reason I've stayed in public relations for so long is it's absolutely fascinating. Whether you're starting out, whether you're changing your career, whether you've been around for 10, 20 years, what we do is we help organisations communicate more effectively. And whether you're selling me Clarins, and I spend an enormous amount of money on Clarins, so that's very important to me, you know, I feel special, I feel valued, I receive great communication from that brand. Or whether it's working with the NHS, who save people's lives day in, day out, ensuring that patients know how they can access services, where they can get the best treatment, or whether you're working for an organisation that is promoting great British produce. You know, all of these things, I think we are best placed to help organisations communicate and listen and improve the product that they are offering or the service that they are delivering. I think it's a brilliant profession. I think there are some really inspirational people working in academia, working in really new ways of delivering public relations. I think the whole social media landscape is extremely exciting. We're coming up to an election. I think that in itself is extremely exciting for those of us that are involved in public relations and communications, either directly through colleagues in public affairs or indirectly looking at how organisations are going to respond to an election or post-election. It's very hard work. You know, if you don't like early starts and late finishes, I suggest you go and find something else. And I think if you don't want to be prepared to ask the difficult questions, then go and find another job. And I guess that's about the ethical professional standards that I would encourage everybody to adhere to. And as the president of the Chartered Institute of Public Relations, of course I would say by joining an organisation like ours, you get a huge amount of access to what's great, and you get a huge amount of support for when things aren't going so well.